Thank you, Jono.
Mike and Mal Leyland were pioneers in filming remote Australia, and each week millions of Australians right around the country tuned in to watch the brothers' next adventure. But their cheerful smiles and outgoing personalities hid a dark secret. Mal is about to speak with Ida, but first, a reminder of the TV show Aussies love to watch.
Mike and Mal Leyland were 10-pound pom boys who discovered their love of documentary filmmaking in Australia. After winning a trip to the Melbourne Olympic Games, their father gave Mike a film camera. At a time when much of the country was still a remote frontier, the Leylands brought the outback right into people's lounge rooms.
No matter whatever that happens to be, ask the Leyland brothers.
Throughout the 70s and the 80s, the Leyland brothers enjoyed unlimited success. However, the good times came to a close when a failed theme park venture in the 90s saw them file for bankruptcy.
In hindsight, Leyland Brothers World was a huge mistake. Biggest mistake we ever made.
Today, their incredible legacy lives on, credited with revolutionising the way we Australians travel across this big brown land.
Please welcome Mal Leyland.
Mal, millions of Australians tuned in to watch your show. And you and your brother seem like the best of friends. What happens when the cameras were off you both?
Well, we were brothers, and as you can imagine, like most brothers, we didn't always get on, didn't always agree. We had a few differences of opinion in the early days, but as we went on, they gradually became more serious. But overall, most of our arguments in the first part of it was about the professionalism of what we were doing. Mike was a better cameraman than me and always would be. But when it came to the script and the music, that was my business. So most of them were professional disagreements there. It was only later on that things started to get different.
Well, all siblings argue though, don't they?
Of course. I don't think we're any different in that respect. I think we're quite remarkable that we actually worked together for 45 years.
And the business partnership was 29 years, I think.
Yes, roughly, yeah. Well, it depends on when you want, how far you want to take it back, but we made our first film in 1963 when we went down the Darling, and that makes it 52 years. Mm. Maths was never a strong point with me.
Don't worry about it. Your adventure's made up for everything. So you write in the book about a sense of mistrust. Your brother had a sense of mistrust about you.
He did. I didn't realise that at the beginning, and it crept in. In little bits. I think when we were under a lot of stress after we'd built our big tourist park.
The Leyland Brothers World.
Yes, well, you know, this was a multi-million dollar exercise. We'd sunk all of our own money into it, around about $6 million. We borrowed another $3 million. We were under a lot of stress, and I think that brought those stresses that would be differences between us to the surface more.
But in the beginning it did quite well, didn't it?
You
made,
oh, yeah.
I think you made $3.6 million in the first year.
That's right.
So, but the interest rates crippled you.
Well, yes, when we first opened, first started building it, the interest rates were around about 11%, and by the time we'd finished, they'd risen to 28%. Mm. And that required us to find $2,000 a day in interest alone. Pretty hard to do, even with a successful park.
And the banks foreclosed.
Yes, yeah, banks are a four-letter word to me. But in the end, I don't actually regret having taken the risk. I mean, if I could live my life over again, I wouldn't do that, obviously. But none of us get that chance.
Yeah.
But, I mean, the bank really did what they had to do. They foreclosed. But we got treated badly by individuals. The media had a shot at us as well.
Yeah.
Mike and I then had nothing holding us together. Our investments that we had.
But there must have been something for you both to go into business together. And yet you say he had this sense of distrust about you. Why did he have this? And why then, if he had it, did he go into this a huge investment for you both?
Well, in a sense, it was. We had the idea many years earlier, and then when Mike left Pat, which was his first wife, his estate was diminished quite a bit, and he wanted to go back to the idea of building the park. So I thought, you know, yeah, why not? And Lorraine and my wife and I, we sold up all our investments and put our money into it. And that was the thing, as I said, looking back on it, I wouldn't have done it. But it was a great exercise, and we actually did a good job of what we did. People liked what they saw when they came there. But the stresses of trying to make all those payments put a lot of strain on our relationship between me and my brother.
I bet it did. And what was the last discussion, chat, meeting that you had with your brother?
Well, unfortunately, it was when we had reconciled things a bit by then. Lorraine and I had moved up into the country and were living on a farm, and I got a call to say I better come down and see him because he had Parkinson's disease and it was degenerating. He was degenerating very quickly. It was rapid onset, which meant from by the time it was diagnosed to the time that he actually died, it was only 3 years. He was very close to the end when I went down and had some time with him. I spent 2 days and I didn't get a chance to really talk to him. Because it was a one-way conversation.
He didn't quite remember everything, did he? In the book you write about that, that you were trying to find a way to communicate with him, and you did some gestures that you used to do when you made the series
together.
Yeah,
we did a sort of thumbs up to the camera thing, you know. And as I was leaving, I sort of did that. And he tried to raise his hand, even though he was almost crippled. And, you know, bear in mind, he was in the wheelchair and he needed help just to get up and go to the toilet or anything. And it was quite moving. I felt it was pretty sad.
Very sad.
And I had to... I just said, farewell, mate, I've got to go. And they were my last words to him. When I got down to the car where Lorraine was sitting in the front seat ready to go, I had to sit there for a good 15 minutes before I felt I was fit enough to drive the car.
I'm sure you did.
I was very emotional.
All those memories.
It was the last time I saw him alive.
And in the meantime, you'd had your own battle with cancer.
Yes, indeed. I was diagnosed 22 years ago with bladder cancer. It's something that blokes don't talk about much. We tend to be a bit stoic and pretend it's not happening, whereas ladies tend to talk about their personal things and guys don't. But I was lucky to have it diagnosed early. I had 36 operations, 130 tumours removed.
Wow.
Over the next few years, every 3 months I had to now have another checkup. And in the end, I did lose my bladder. I'm still looking for it.
So are you a cancer survivor?
I am indeed. And I would very much like my book to encourage people that are diagnosed with cancer to never give up. It is not the end necessarily. Keep a positive attitude, always be positive, and I think that you've got a chance of getting a lot more out of your life. One thing that I did do was throw my watch away when I was told I had 18 months to live, which was at the start, because I figure I'm not going to measure the rest of it in hours and minutes. But after a while, Lorraine got sick of me asking at the time, so I did eventually get a little fob watch, which I carry around now.
Well, thank you for the time you spent with me at this moment, and we'll be back to talk with you further shortly.
Thank you.
And Mal's book is called Still Travelling and is out now. But stay with us because our chat with Mal will continue right after this short break, where he'll relive happier times. Special guest today is Mal Leyland. Now, Mal, how much of this success was planned, or did you just have a really good gut feeling you were onto something good? Because you had extraordinary success in Australia.
Well, we always knew what we wanted to do from a childhood, but it was ridiculously ambitious considering the knowledge we didn't have. But we were so audacious. When you're young, you just think everything's possible and you just get in and do it. And in fact, it is. And I want any young people watching the program to actually have that. If they've got a dream, go chase it.
Because, Mal, I grew up watching you on the television, and my dad and I especially loved your show. And it really, I think for me and probably a lot of other young Australians, gave us a sense of how wonderful Australia was and that there was so much to explore. And before that, there wasn't really much on telly that did that.
Well, no, there wasn't in a way. And we were actually inspired by the early works of David Attenborough.
Right.
And we used to watch his show and thought, we'd like to do that. And being young, we thought there was no reason why not. Mm. And it was a bit of a battle, but we got there, and in the end it was our little battles with the elements and the various things that we came across that made up part of our program. Mm.
So, Mal, what was it like when you finally hit success, though, going from not known to...
Well, the difficult part of it was that we used to have these signs on the side of our vehicles. We were all sign written everywhere we went. People knew who we were, and it got to be difficult to actually get the job done. So we had magnetic ones made so we could tear them off and try and go incognito. But that didn't work either because they recognised us everywhere we went. But the best part about it was that we got to meet so many wonderful Australian people. And we've got a great country, haven't we?
Yeah.
I
mean,
I was just about to say on that point, often we travel right around the world and we don't travel enough as Australians in our own wonderful country. How important is it to teach the younger generation what an extraordinary country we live in?
I think it's vital because we really have a unique country. I can go anywhere. We can all go, 3,000 miles in the old sort of measure, right across. And we don't cross any border. We don't need to carry a passport.
Yes.
You do that. That's the same distance London to Moscow.
Our whole family actually pulled up stumps and went around Australia for 3 months, right when the Leyland Brothers was... The Leyland Brothers is the reason we...
We're responsible for that, aren't we?
That's right. Complete family breakdown as well. The other thing is the song, I'm going to have it in my head for forever. It is just the catchiest thing in the world. How much do you reckon that was a driver in just how memorable the show was? Because you can still hum it to yourself now, 20, 30 years later.
Well, it's one of
how
about...
How did you come up with it?
It was about 30-odd songs that were written for us by the Provost Brothers. They were a couple of guys that used to... They didn't write music, but they could play by ear. We sat down with them and gave them a few ideas, gave them a few of the lines. They improved on it, came up with a little jingle, and we said it had to be 45 seconds. That was it. Wow. And, of course... We didn't realise we'd still be using it 16 years later.
It's up there with aeroplane jelly, isn't it? It's that whole genre of ads.
Now, there's something to achieve, isn't it? Yeah. To be up there with aeroplane jelly.
Mal, thank you so much for joining us and thank you for sharing this story.
Yeah, thank you.
Absolute pleasure. And Mal's book, as we mentioned, Still Travelling, is available in great bookstores right now.